As people come in and take their seats, I want to welcome everyone to this panel entitled Creativity in the Art Classroom. My name is Ardina Greco, and I am a teaching artist in the Learning Through Art program here at the Guggenheim Museum. It's really my honor to be with all these individuals and be the moderator for this panel. Earlier this morning, we learned a little bit about the Art for Problem Solving research that the Guggenheim has doing for the last 4 years, really looking at how art teaching can develop problem-solving skills in students. In this presentation, we're going to shed light on the practical classroom issues. Specifically, we're going to focus on the teaching strategies believed to encourage creative habits and skills. I'm accompanied on stage with four individuals who experiences and insight are invaluable to the discussion. They are Stephanie Downing, they are Ascha Kells Drake, and we have Lois Hetland and Ellen Winner. We're going to begin with Stephanie Downey, who is the managing director of Randi, Korn & Associates. Stephanie worked directly with the Learning Through Art program on the Art for Problem Solving research to formulate research questions and to facilitate the advisory team in the development of measurement tools and instruments. She also oversaw the collection of analysis of data as well as the preparation of the final report. So let's welcome Stephanie.
Thank you. So this morning, or in the previous panel, you heard my colleagues Randi and Amanda talk about the findings from the Art of Problem Solving research study. They focused primarily on the student outcomes, which most directly address our hypothesis, which is that students who participate in LTA will demonstrate greater problem-solving skills than students who do not participate in LTA. I want to continue this discussion of this hypothesis, but from a different angle. So rather than talking about student outcomes related to problem solving, I'm going to focus on teaching behaviors related to problem solving. I put this slide up as a reminder of the various measures that we used in this study. The first few relate to the student outcomes, and I'm going to focus on the item in bold, which is the teaching artist observations. And Amy talked about this a little bit when she was talking about the design of the study. I'm going to go into more depth with that. The observations helped us see the extent to which teaching artists exhibited the behaviors that we believe necessary to develop and support students' problem-solving skills. And I'm going to talk about, as I present, I will tell you what those teaching behaviors look like. But before I tell you what the behaviors are and before I present the findings from the observation, I want to talk about the process we went through in defining, or first identifying the teaching behaviors and then defining them very concretely so that we could develop an observation instrument. And Randi talked about planning and how important that was to this project. The first year, as she said, was spent just on planning, and developing the teaching artist observation guide was part of that. There were several inspirations that helped us in the process of identifying the teaching artist behaviors that we believe cultivate problem-solving skills. First of all was the rubric that you have in your packets that Amanda talked about. But we didn't use the rubric as a one-to-one correlation. It was just a part of many things that we used in identifying the teaching behaviors. Another inspiration came from working with the advisory team who have expertise in the area of problem solving. They provided invaluable input and feedback as we developed all the instruments, including the teaching artist observation guide. A third inspiration was actually the original Learning Through Art program goals and objectives, which were developed many years ago and refined over the years. So we went back to these goals and objectives because they define very concretely what teaching artists are expected to accomplish in LTA. Another inspiration was exploratory observations. So we as the evaluation team went into LTA sessions and did exploratory observations, watching the teaching artist, looking at the strategies she was using, thinking about problem solving. Some members of the advisory team also did that, went into the classroom and observed. And, of course, the LTA administrative staff have observed hundreds of LTA sessions. And then finally, sort of the overriding, probably most important inspiration was this idea of artists' habits. So we asked the question, what are the habits of mind that artists use when they develop or create their works of art? So combined, all these inspirations led us to the identification of four teaching behaviors that I'm going to show you in just a moment, and Amy showed you earlier. After we identified them, the next step was to refine them and get them, make them as concrete as possible so that we could observe them through an observation guide. In your packets, you actually have the observation guide. I'm going to hold it up so you can find it quickly. It looks like this. I think it's on the right side. The front is the actual checklist that observers used in the classroom, and then the back has the teaching artist behaviors and definitions of those. And I'm going to go through this now. So, as I said, we identified four teaching artist behaviors that we believe to be necessary to cultivate students' problem-solving skills. The first one we called multiple approaches and individual solutions. This is teaching students that there are many possible ways to approach a task and that each individual should arrive at the solution that best meets his or her intentions. The second behavior is questioning assumptions and following one's curiosity. This is teaching students to think by questioning. So asking the question, I wonder what would happen if I tried something different, or I wonder what would happen if I tried the opposite of what I'm trying right now. This is to promote students to think outside the box and to get out of their comfort zone. The third one is we call deliberate intentions and choice making. This is teaching students to make choices based on their specific idea in trying to convey a particular aesthetic or a particular idea or meaning. And then the last one we call seeing problems as opportunities. This is teaching students to work with or through a mistake or a problem or a challenge that they encounter as they're making their artwork, rather than giving up or starting over. And in developing these four areas, we realized that they could manifest in different ways in the classroom. So we also came up with four categories that define, I'm calling them the method of delivery. These are also on the back of your observation guide. And they are to recognize, this is when the teaching artist points out a problem-solving behavior in a student or among a group of students. The next one is to challenge. This is when a teaching artist instructs or encourages students to use a particular problem-solving behavior. Model is when the teaching artist demonstrates the problem-solving behavior. And show examples is when the teaching artist shows how problem-solving behaviors manifest in a particular work of art. So this would happen often during the inquiry portion of LTA when the teaching artist show examples of artwork from the Guggenheim collection. So they might be able to talk about the artist's process and how he or she may have encountered problems along the way. I'm going to give you a couple of examples. Those definitions sound really sort of abstract until you see them in practice. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples. So, for instance, this is an example of challenging a student to question assumptions, and this is from an actual LTA session. This took place during the art-making portion of LTA when the students are busy at their desk working on their art projects. And during that time, the teaching artists typically circulate among the students, checking their work, asking questions. And in this instance, the teaching artists asked, have you considered all the different ways your building can stand? You can rotate your building and look at it from a different way. I wonder how it would change if it was rotated. So you can see how she was encouraging students to think about what they were doing in a different way. And I have one more example. This is an example of recognizing deliberate intentions and choice making. This took place during the reflection period of LTA, which usually happens toward the end of the 90-minute session after students have been working for a while. And in this case, the teaching artist was standing in front of the classroom, and she's asking one student to hold up her work of art and says, "I see you have lots of colors in your portrait. Do these colors have different meanings, and can you tell us what each color represents?" And then the student answered that yellow represented being shy, green for happy, and orange for her skin color. And then the teaching artist reaffirms that and says to the class that this is an example how different colors can convey different ideas or different meanings. Now I'll talk about the actual process of doing the observations and collecting the data, and then I'll give you the findings. So to assess the use of these behaviors and methods in LTA, we observed each of the three teaching artists who were in the treatment schools 9 times over the course of 2 years, so 18 times each they were observed. And Ascha was one, right? So she knows we were there a lot. And so at the end, we had a total of 54 observations of full 90-minute LTA sessions. To ensure that the observation data was reliable, we hired a team of observers who did not know the research hypothesis, and we trained them extensively to recognize these behaviors. So we went into the classroom with teams, and we did observations together, and then afterwards we talked about what we had seen, and then we did it again. So we made sure they knew what they were looking for. And you can see on your observation guide that on the front, the checklist, they not only marked whether they had seen a behavior, but they were required to provide an example. And then back in our office, when we got the data back, we reviewed those examples to make sure they really did represent the behavior we were looking for. Another way we made sure the data was reliable is that we had 2 observers present for each observation. They completed separate observation forms, and they didn't talk with one another about what they were seeing. They sat in separate sides of the room, and they handed in their observation forms, and back in the office, we compared their work. And this was just another way of making sure our data was reliable. So now I'm going to present the findings. These findings serve as important context for understanding the student outcomes, and they indicate the degree to which problem solving was present in the LTA sessions. Overall, the findings are very positive. So of the 4 problem solving areas, the ones most frequently taught to students were deliberate and intentional choice making and knowing that there are multiple approaches to a task. So you can see that these 2 areas were covered in nearly every single observation. Less often, they taught students to question assumptions and to see problems as opportunities. But you can still see that it was done frequently in more than half of every observation. And then when it came to the 4 methods of delivery, most often teaching artists recognized and challenged these problem-solving areas, and less often they showed examples and modeled these problem-solving areas. But again, it still was happening in more than half of every observation. So now I'm going to transition from me to our next speaker, Ascha, and I'm going to do that by showing you a 6-minute video clip of an LTA session. And in this video, Ascha is giving a demonstration during an LTA session. And as you watch it, I want you to have the observation guide in front of you and just look for these different skills and feel free to mark up the paper. We're not going to test you on it later, but just see if you notice Ascha using these various problem-solving areas. And so we're ready for the video now.
Your challenge, though, is you have to use every bit of cardboard you take. So if I decide to snip off a piece of cardboard, I've got to use this somehow. Something else we did with paper, which I'm going to write down, is we stacked it. And then we can build with it, right? So that's very much something that we're going to think about with cardboard today. So who has an idea of which piece I should start with? What do you think? Yeah?
The fattest piece.
The fattest piece, okay. And what do you think I should do to this? If we've been talking about buildings and how architects begin from the bottom and then build up. So what could I do to this to start working with it?
Yeah. Fold it.
Okay, I'll try folding it. Also, something, this cardboard is pretty forgiving, so you can really do some interesting stuff with it, okay? Huh, and then I start to actually make that roll, right? I'm rolling it. Now again, on your desks, there's gonna be all this masking tape. So let's say for now, this is my desk. And Sophie and I will just go around and keep putting tape around. We have thin masking tape and thick masking tape. So that's artist choice about which tape works better for you. With paper, we talked about the wiggle test and keeping things structurally balanced. That's one of your words on your vocab list, balance. So that's a goal today, balance with the form. So feel free to use as much tape as you need, and your fingertips are gonna be a great tool to really press down the tape and get it all stuck on there. So that's a good beginning, right? Okay, what else could I do? Yeah.
You can twist it.
Okay, but what could I do? I've got this three-dimensional shape, and my goal is to stack the shapes and connect them to create a structure, which could influence some kind of building, I imagine, in the world. Yeah?
You could use the piece that you cut out.
And what can I do with it?
You could put it on top.
Okay. I could put it on top. Now, to do this, working with this material is really physical. So today, stand if you want to, or sit. You might hold the piece. And to attach this, you might put one piece of tape like this. Again, really pressing. And then I need a piece of tape on the other side. That was a great suggestion, though. Does it pass the wiggle test? I might even consider wrapping. That's a huge part of masking tape, wrapping around to hold it tight. So I could play around with the orientation. It could go like that. It could go like that. Yeah.
You could put it like that, and then on the top, like, cut both sides and put another piece of cardboard.
Oh, now we're talking. Now you're getting into something else we did, which was slot and tab. You remember? So I think you're telling me that I can make a slot and make a slot like that.
And then put a piece of
paper. And then, ha. Now, you can feel free to change the shape of things. Like maybe I don't want that hard edge. Maybe I want it more organic. Okay, so maybe I like this. But these pieces, I still have to use somehow. So we're not going to be throwing away any cardboard today. The challenge is to use it all up. I'm sort of interested in that. And then I'm sort of interested in building. This slot and tabbing is very useful. But then I might think, nope, okay. So I'm going to work with it. Maybe I make it shorter. Problem solve. Okay, now the slot and tab is great, but you might need to come in and reinforce it with a little bit of tape so it does indeed pass the wiggle test. Okay, all right. Also play around with, I've been looking at my form this way. What happens if it lies on its back, right? What happens if I bend this and make it stand this way? Right? How am I going to get this piece into there? I kind of like that idea of having it stick out like that. So I could do what I call a tape sandwich. Okay, so a tape sandwich is when you put one piece of tape on one side and one piece of tape on the other side and then stick it on like that, wrapping. So it holds tight somewhat. And then I could do some more wrapping. Okay? So please feel free to use as much tape as you need today. There was an artist in Miss Wyndham's class who wrapped their whole structure in masking tape. They made a whole nother skin. But then there were artists that were really interested in the material of the cardboard and having that be revealed.
So Asha's, we already got an introduction to her teaching, but in addition, I want to say that she's also an artist. She has worked at the Guggenheim for many years, and her students were in participation with the study, even though she didn't really know what the study was about. So we'll hear more from Asha now.
Thank you, Ardina, and thank you, Stephanie. Being an artist is often messy, frustrating, slow-moving, and requires stillness, which I am always finding in my studio. But acknowledging that so much of that frustration and moving through problems and ultimately getting to the end result is so satisfying. So this idea of merging my practice as a teaching artist into the classroom has been this really interesting dance and collaboration. I see myself as a collaborator and an encourager of encouraging students to be sensitive observers of the world, open to a shift in plans and aware of their needs and resources. So in preparing for this moment, I really had to think about the processes that I value in my own studio practice and then how do I cultivate those values in the studio. And then going through my treasure trove of images, trying to show you visually what that looks like is very, very difficult. So within these images, there's a lot of flexibility, and I will explain the motivation as to why I chose the images. But I think looking at images of students in their process of making is very important. As a teaching artist, I think a lot about how do we encourage students to think like artists? What is it like to think like an artist? And what is the benefit of encouraging students to think like artists? Also, just a reminder, as a teaching artist, I was going into classrooms, collaborating with the classroom teachers for a period of 20 sessions. And each session was 90 minutes long. So there's a huge advantage in that time for lingering, for looking, for constant reflection. And then this dialogue with the classroom teacher. And so that's something else that I'm fascinated in, is how the classroom teacher takes on these processes that I value and continues that dialogue. And does that happen, or does it disappear when my presence is no longer there? I'm also fascinated by systems that students are developing as artists and how they take those systems and then transfer them into their math curriculum, into their language arts curriculum. And then this beauty of recognizing relationships. Just recently, I'm now living in Oakland, California, but just thinking about how the students that I'm working with are now automatically taking on their practices as artists, and when they need to brainstorm or when they're frustrated with something, taking their sketchbook, which is a practice that I am constantly encouraging, and working through problems that way, or going to Yosemite, and instead of just gazing and looking and reflecting just orally with their peers, to take out a sketchbook and record their experience in that space. So just these practices continuing on and expanding. So here we go. So in thinking about my values, which are very connected to the studio habits of mind, and then these are values that I'm looking for with my students. And there are many, many others that I could have talked about, but there isn't time. So cultivating and gathering ideas, acknowledging choices, exploring and experimenting with materials, open to problem solving, being flexible, articulating ideas and needs, following through with a project, and then reflecting on the process. Again, sketchbooks are a major source of reflection. I call them a treasure trove of ideas. And so initially in a session, I will ask the artists in the classroom, where do artists get ideas? So they start to really open up their minds and see that ideas come from just so many places. And as mathematicians or as scientists or as writers, ideas come from those same places. So making these connections. But I just loved these visual diagrams. Again, this development of systems, and then how do they take these systems and use them in other areas of their lives. Research, and again, students having this flexibility and comfort of taking their sketchbooks, gathering research, and I often start off a session with my own sketchbooks and show students the frustration or the moments of obliterating ideas, the moments of changing a whole page, or the moments of having that spark. And I talk to students a lot about that spark and that trusting of the gut, which they're at first like, what is that trusting of the gut? But important. So a lot of these word webs and just, you know, always weaving in literacy and getting students to really articulate ideas and not be aware of spelling and just get the ideas out. And you may use them now, you may use them later, or never use them, but they're there. And again, these just reminders and opening up to what is possible. And then taking ideas, and if you have the motivation, where do you take them? And how are these ideas transformed and led into other things? So I loved this image of this very clear, strong sketch, and then this beginning of a styrofoam printing plate. Acknowledging choices. So I talk to students, and I'm very candid with students about my practice as a teaching artist, or as an artist, and my practice as a teaching artist, and how I bring those two dialogues and practices together. And so very much interested in giving students choices, because I talk about my studio as a space that has, you know, boxes and boxes of just gathering sites and gathering grounds. So giving students that same opportunity. And I think a lot about demonstrations and watching that video of myself thinking about, like, how do we as teaching artists demonstrate to, we don't want to influence too much, and how do you give them ideas to then take the ideas on into their own spaces. So doing many demonstrations and then allowing students to choose cardboard if that's what's going to articulate their vision, or choose paper if they want to work with that malleable material. So setting up these material areas, just as I would have in my own studio, and allowing students to go and take as much or as little as they need. And then this beautiful idea of transforming the classroom into a studio. And then again, this idea of how do the classroom teachers then utilize that idea. But allowing students to lay their materials out, lay them on the floor. And I think often, you know, the collaborating teachers, is their control, and that how are students going to respond to that? But I think they appreciate this very physical process of making and editing. And then students articulating that maybe they need to work on the wall, so giving them that opportunity and again, thinking outside the box, and they're very used to working at desks, and then allowing them to engage in their work in the space in a different way. And just working with other artists in the studio or in the classroom, and acknowledging, oh, that artist is working with that material, how can I maybe try that myself? So this beautiful dialogue. Exploring materials. So within the 20-week residency, always giving students the opportunity to muck around with materials and to acknowledge the characteristics and what they possibly could be working with. So standing and taping, and then always, you know, in my own practice, I'm always stepping back and trying to understand why things are working the way they're working or not working, and so asking students to do the same in their own practice, having students stop, turn the piece that they're working on, maybe talk to a neighbor about what's working, what's not working. And then giving students opportunity to, you know, in this situation, just with oil pastels, blending, smearing, filling the whole space, and then connecting it to literacy, and how does that open up the understanding of that material, and could it benefit that particular project? And just was interested in this piece, just with the strong articulation of the oil pastel, and then the desire to leave that white pencil line and not feel compelled to have to fill that in. So just interested in that choice. And this artist experimenting with working with the whole space, again, this energized use of the material. And then the sketchbooks again, always referring back to them, so that's a space to feel safely experimental in, and then having this dialogue going back and forth between what did we learn in that sketchbook practice and how can we apply that. So constant reflection back and forth. And just love this image of the student investigating, like, what if I do peel this area off? And then this constant questioning. What is this going to do? Do I like what this is doing? And just was interested in this image, the experimenting on the right, and then how that then applied to this next step in experimenting on the left, which then led to another self-portrait piece. Problem solving. So again, with students, I always am sitting initially in a circle and talking maybe about something that's happened to me in the studio to encourage them and to remind them that, yes, you may feel frustrated. And just yesterday, I was feeling frustrated with this project and how I got through that. So just liked this image all the different ways, and this reflects back to the video that Stephanie showed, just of students working with that cardboard material, taking on that challenge, and all the different approaches. Just liked the hands on this piece, and just figuring out, you know, what do I do if I bend this piece and butt it up against this other piece? And a student just initially in this project, I had given students the challenge of filling the whole paper space with one drawing of the object that they chose, and the student wanted different perspectives and different applications of the material, which was interesting. And we had seen some sketchbooks of artists, you know, drawing multiple ears or eyes, and how that, where does that lead us in understanding. And just exploring with paint on top of charcoal. That was not the intention for this project, so it was interested that the student was merging the materials. And then just problem solving, which can be playful. So reminding students of that, and that if you are frustrated with something, maybe to move it on the floor, look at it in a different perspective. Articulating needs and ideas. So I come in, I feel like my car, because I am now driving everywhere, is like a traveling art supply store. But that's always been the way I teach, coming in and laying out a materials area. Again, so students have this freedom of taking or returning or taking more from this area. And just, again, going back to the sketchbook over and over, so this gets back to this idea of students being very clear and thoughtful about what the project is going to be about. So always returning to the sketchbook as a place of acknowledging and reflecting. And often I'll ask students to make lists of things that maybe they need for the project. And in this case, the student is really thinking about the theme or intention. often making portfolios, and then on the back of the portfolio that's housing all of these experimentations, students will write down the characteristics of the material. Why might an artist use ink? I didn't like charcoal because it was, what does that say? Like rough, like a rock. So it's for them to just be, again, reflective and to acknowledge what they don't want to use, but of course, complimenting them for trying it at least, and the importance of experimentation, because then you'll be able to articulate your needs. And just was interested in this one, just the combination of the tinfoil and the cardboard. Student is standing, so again, encouraging this physical engagement. And again, this just encouraging articulating what the needs are and intention. So following through with ideas, so starting, of course, with the sketchbook intention and then going through this progression, and in this case, this final piece, but I was interested just looking at the simple shape in the sketchbook and where the student ended up. Again, this progression. So often I liken scientists to artists and like to bring that parallel in. So researching and then sketching from that and then taking it to this next body of work. And starting with one sketch, enlarging it. Process. And reflecting on the process. That, again, goes throughout the residency. So often reflection will start at the beginning of class. Often the reflection will be teamwork. I talk to students a lot about how they have such an advantage of having each other in this studio space. I'm alone in my studio and wish that I had this community to engage with. Often reflection takes place in sketching and going back and forth between 3D and 2D perspectives. Often reflection will take place in a different space. How do we look at things in a space outside the studio differently? So in this case, I took the students' robots outside, and they came to class, and they were suddenly laid out in a row and asked to reflect on each other's work. Again, reflecting on one another's work. And then sometimes reflection takes place. This was after a printmaking project, and I had a table laid out, and when students were finished, they reflected on what they'd learned from printmaking, or they could reflect on what did they learn about themselves as an artist, which is something that I do after every project. So, again, encouraging that practice. So, and that's it. All right.
So we've learned a lot about the Guggenheim's practice through the research and also through Ascha's teaching. And now to complement and deepen this discussion, we've invited two speakers who have worked with the Studio Thinking Initiative at Project Zero Harvard Graduate School of Education. These individuals have worked on research that also aim to identify habits and skills strengthened through quality arts education. More recently, their research has gone further to test some of these skills for transfer in other areas. Lois Hetland is one of those individuals. In addition to her work with Project Zero, Lois is also professor of art education at Massachusetts College of Art and Designs. And following Lois is Ellen Winner. In addition to her work with Project Zero, Ellen is a professor in the chair of the Department of Psychology at Boston College. And so let's welcome Lois and Ellen.
Thanks. It's really interesting to see both the frameworks that the people in the LTA project have developed, as well as Ash's work in the classroom, because I'm realizing how difficult it is once you've sort of learned a particular language to think in another language. I feel sort of like I speak French and this is being conducted in English. And it's really interesting because the studio thinking framework has become the language that I speak. And, you know, I think it's tempting sometimes to think, oh, you know, which one's the right one? And it's like, well, is French the right one? You know, I mean, it's really not that way. It's really just a question of what language does the community speak, and then how do we speak to each other when we have all these different complex, nuanced things that are going on. So the focus today, as it was listed in the program, says, you know, what are the creative habits and skills associated with visual art education, and how can those skills be developed and supported? So I wanted to stick pretty closely to those two ideas, and I will be working on talking about the studio thinking framework, and particularly the studio habits of mind, as a way to talk about the way we're thinking about creative habits and skills, or what we refer to as dispositions. And then Ellen is going to talk more about the current project that we're working on, which is around one of the particular skills, which is envisioning. So the studio habits of mind research was motivated by the previous research project, which was a project to test the common transfer claims that were being made in the arts advocacy community, saying that art was associated with gains in math and reading and cognitive ability of all kinds. Now, I actually believe that transfer like this happens. I believe it because of almost 20 years teaching in classrooms and using art as my primary way of teaching math and language arts and history and science and stuff like that. And but these claims were based on science. They were saying the scientific evidence, science has shown that. And that seemed, I couldn't find those studies. So it seemed like I wanted to see if they really were there. And so we spent a long time trying to find those studies. We did what's called a meta-analysis, and it was an exhaustive research study. Primarily, its credibility relies on the strength of the search that we did for these studies, because we needed to find as many possible studies as possible, and that includes unpublished studies, those studies that people kind of looked at the results and said, oh, this doesn't really show anything, and they stick it back in their file cabinets and it never gets published. But that's part of the research literature too. So we spent probably 18 months digging up studies. And these claims, by the way, are not claims that are happening everywhere. They're happening mostly in the United States, and we were really wondering about whether there was causal evidence to make scientific claims. You know, in Britain, they weren't making the same kind of claims, and so that suggests somehow that it might be related to a political climate rather than to something else, and that's actually what I think. So we did this project called Reviewing Education in the Arts Project. It was published in 2000 in the Journal of Aesthetic Education. That's a special double issue that was published with 10 meta-analyses that we did on different kinds of art forms and different outcomes. So was the outcome visual arts, or was it dance or music? And then we had a conference at the Getty Center in which we discussed these findings and had some people come and critique us. And those findings are published in this other publication called Beyond the Soundbite, which is a much less technical and more sort of user-friendly set of articles. And it also is available in a PDF for free online. So that's what that little indication is, if you wanted to get that. Does it? Oh, it worked fine on my Mac. It's www.getty.edu/ foundation, maybe? I don't know. /PDF/soundbite.pdf. Okay. At any rate, in these meta-analyses, we did 10 of them, and we out of the 10 that we did, we found that 7 of them did not demonstrate a causal relationship. So our suspicion that the science was not showing, was not the foundation of these claims, was borne out. The claims were really exceeding the evidence for transfer from the arts to non-arts learning at this time. Again, this doesn't say that it doesn't happen. This says that the scientific evidence is not there on which to base such a claim. And what happened was that there was just a fury. It was awful for me. I hated it. I really hated it. I had been teaching in a classroom for 20 years, and that's not a very controversial kind of environment. And then I just started my doctoral program, and all of us, the very first work that I did, because I was doing it with her, launched me into this sort of international position of, I guess, fame, but what it really was international position of criticism. Because basically all the arts advocates were furious because we were saying that the emperor had no clothes. And the cognitive scientists hated us because they said this was stupid research and we shouldn't be wasting our time on it. So it was a really bizarre way to be thrust into prominence. At any rate, we lived through it. And what we realized is that part of the motivation for making claims about art's capacity to transfer learning to other domains was probably because we didn't know how to talk about the learning that happened in the arts itself. And so we said, okay, let's pick an art. We picked visual art because the Getty was funding us and they're a visual arts organization. And then we said, okay, well, let's find some places where we know that the quality of what goes on there is good enough, that the kids are getting a rigorous enough treatment in enough of a dose that if something happens, we'll see it. So we weren't trying to make a judgment about, you know, the kind of education that was being delivered. We just wanted it to be serious, taught by artists, and we wanted it to be at least 9 hours a week. And so it was not an experimental study. This was a qualitative study that we were trying to, it was basically building theory. And this is the book it's published in. Come on, there we go. All right, so when we started looking, we knew we were asking basically two questions. We were saying, what is it that art teachers are teaching, and why are they doing it that way? And what we found out was that this idea that David Perkins and colleagues at Project Zero have developed, this idea of a disposition, fit very nicely with what we were seeing. And what this idea is that skill, while it's a very, very important thing to be teaching, is not good enough. It's great, and it's important, and it's necessary. But if it's all you're teaching, then you kind of miss the boat. Because if somebody has, let's say they can read, but they're not inclined to ever pick up a book and use those skills, then it's kind of like, what difference does it make that they read or that they have the skills of reading? Because they don't read. So one of the things we realized is that the teachers were teaching inclination to use skills as well as skill. Now, some people will say, you can't do that. You can't teach you can take a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Well, you can't really teach skill either. You can't teach anything. Basically, all you can do is you can facilitate learning. Right? So I don't think it's a very good argument to say that you can't teach inclination. It's just that you don't do it in the same way as you teach skill. I think you teach inclination by through relationship, through setting up cultures of learning, through setting up peer context, through all sorts of social kinds of dynamics and reward structures. It's just different. Oh my gosh, my minutes are over. Well, that's it. I have to stop. Okay, I'll rush. The third element of dispositions is alertness. And alertness is this idea of context. And again, it's, you know, if I have the skills to read and I actually pick up books, but I just do so randomly, then it's like I'm not actually using reading for what it can be used for, which is to learn about stuff. So I need to be alert to those opportunities that come up in life and in projects and in endeavors that I take on, that it's like, ooh, you know, this would be a really great time to read something. And then I can use my inclination and my skill to actually figure something out. So these three elements, it turns out, are the elements of the eight dispositions that we found out that we call the Studio Habits of Mind. And you've got a handout in your folder that defines them. And I call this the flying pie slide, so I'll just fly in the slides. There are eight studio habits. We argued like crazy to come up with eight. There really are 11, but we cheated because three of them have two parts. Understand Art World has two parts. And those are domain, meaning the stuff that's been made in art history, and then communities, which is how artists work in communities. And if you think about what Ascha was saying, that it's, you could see both of those things happening. Recently, I've really gotten interested myself in teaching from the contemporary, and I think it's really critical. That's my bias about Understand Art World. But Understand Art World as a disposition is neutral. It doesn't say that you should teach from the contemporary. It doesn't say that you should teach visual culture, or you should teach material culture, or you should teach modern art. It doesn't say any of those things. What it says is that artists have the disposition to think with the objects that have been made and are being made. They have the skills, the inclination, and the alertness to do so. And they also have the skills, inclination, and alertness to work in community, in various levels and kinds of community. Develop craft is the idea of technique, and we called it studio practice, which is this idea of how a studio works. And it was really interesting to hear you talking about setting up the classroom as a studio. That's all about the studio practices. And again, you might think, oh, skill is what develop craft is all about. But actually, there's the inclination to use skill, and then there's the alertness to know when those skills need to be used. You don't always, in every stage of every project, need to be focusing on technique. And if you are, you'll miss the point. You won't advance. Engage and persist. We saw people teaching this all the time. A lot of times the engage part of engage and persist somehow gets skipped over in people's minds when they're thinking about this. But it's that, how do you learn to engage? How do you learn to find problems, to figure out what it is you're going to make art about? Because you really need to engage in order to persist. Because the persisting is going to get hard. It's going to get rocky. You're going to come into places where you don't know what to do. And if you're not engaged, you'll give it up. So there are all sorts of skills of persisting, but there's also the inclination and the alertness to persist and to figure out how to engage in order to do that. Envisioning is very similar to what you guys were talking about imagining. Basically, it's everything that isn't in form. It's figuring out the mental processes. How do you see something that doesn't yet exist? And artists have a gazillion ways of doing that. Express is this idea of symbolizing in the symbol systems of the art forms those things that we're trying to say. So express is about meaning. One of the interesting things I've found out, we noticed from the very beginning that the studio habits operate in clusters, but we didn't know what those clusters meant. And now what I'm finding is that the clusters are what motivate and define quality. So, for example, I'm teaching beginning art teachers, and I insist that if they're having developed craft, that they have to get the kids thinking about the tension between developed craft and express. It's not either it's meaning or you're developing craft. It's that meaning drives craft and craft refers back to meaning. And you've got to have that dynamic going on all the time. So Express is the Isadora Duncan, if I could say it, I wouldn't have to dance it. It's that habit. Observe is the habit of looking closely, more closely than ordinary looking requires, and giving looking time and using systems for thinking. And you can see that observe links very closely with envision, because observe is the outside world and envision is that world on the inside. And so there's an interaction between them. It was really interesting to hear the definition given earlier about the difference between reflect and evaluate, because we have a habit that's called reflect, question, and explain, and then the other part is reflect, evaluate. So often I actually think what we mean by reflection in an ordinary language kind of way is what we call envisioning. But it's also part of reflect, question, and explain. And that's the flip side of the Isadora Duncan problem that says, look, artists got to talk about art. They got to have words. They got to figure out how to use those words. And they've got to figure out when to make the words shut up. Because sometimes the words get in your way. And you've got to say, look, I'm not dealing with you right now. I'm dealing with red. I'm dealing with cardboard. You know, I'm talking in that language. I'm not going to talk in you right now. But there are other times when I do have to talk and I have to write. And I have to listen. And then reflect, evaluate is the part of how do you make judgments? Elliot Eisner talks about making judgment in the absence of rule. And it's true, artists, because art is always innovating, it's always pushing at the edges of the known, the determined, the decided, into the new. The reflect, evaluate idea has to understand that you have to make judgments when there aren't any rules. Duchamp's fountain wasn't a great piece of sculpture when he made it. You know, they rejected, they were furious at the Biennale. But now it's an icon of found object art, of contemporary sculpture. So you have to use the rules where they exist. You have to eschew the rules where they get in your way. And you have to listen to intersubjective judgment and your own intuitions. And somehow you've got to come up with a balance among all those. And then, well, the last one, I call it the last one because it's the last one I'm going to say anything about. But you see they're in alphabetical order, and they're non-hierarchical. So it's not as if this one's more important or that one's more important. These are eight interacting habits of mind. Stretch and explore is where that idea of error comes into our framework. It's the idea of reaching beyond your capacity and making mistakes and using those mistakes as opportunities either to diagnose what went wrong and figure out better approaches, or to get new ideas. It's playful, it's exploratory. So those are the eight studio habits. We're hoping that they would be internalized in a student. In order to internalize them, it makes it more likely if the teacher brings them into the classroom. But you can see that they live in the art world and they live beyond the art world. So the teacher has to make professional choices about what of each of those habits they bring in. That's the neutrality of the habits, and that's why I think they're such a comfortable fit for so many people, because they can take on the flavor of your teaching, your practice, your students.
This might be your unit.
9 seconds.
And what happens if you start alternating, building a whole sculpture up this way?
So that's Jason Green, who is one of our teaching artists, and he was talking there about envisioning. So I'm going to show it since it's only 9 seconds. I'm going to let you see it again. So remember envisioning. He's trying to help this person to see something in her head that would help her then to, I think I can do this, that would help her then to build it in actual form.
This might be your unit. And what happens if you start alternating and building a whole sculpture up this way?
Okay, and Ellen's going to talk more about envisioning. Okay, so just to conclude, these are the ways that we have seen teachers supporting students in developing creative skills and attitudes. Teachers are expanding what they value as worthwhile to include in teaching. So there are what you could call creativity dispositions, which stretch and explore would clearly be one, envisioning, expressing. You could actually call all of them, but I think sort of in descending order, that list that I've put up there is sort of the way I see creativity. Development of inclination and alertness in addition to skill. So that's when we see people start to use the studio habits, those are two things that happen. Teachers first tend to assess their own teaching and curriculum or their own studio practice to see where they're doing these various habits. That's the first thing that they do, even if you ask them to do something else. Then teachers revise their curriculum, looking for elements of classroom culture that they can change to support things, changing their curriculum and assessment practices, dedicating more time to the kinds of formative assessment that might move them kids along in different particular habits, and also participating in professional learning conversations. These have become a language among French speakers. There are studio habit speakers, and it's not the only language that can be spoken, but it is one that's proving to be very effective in describing many of the nuances that we need to when we're talking about something as subtle and as important as art, both in visual art and in other artistic disciplines like dance and music and drama. That's it. Thanks.
While the slides are being set up, I'll just give you a brief introduction of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about an experiment that we're now doing that grows out of the Studio Thinking Project. One of the main problems that Lois and I encountered when we reviewed the earlier literature testing the claim that when students study the arts, test scores improve, is that we found that none of the studies actually described what was going on in the art classroom. They just said, students are getting the arts. Let's see if their test scores improve. And we felt that it was really important to first understand what was being taught in the art program and what was being learned. Because without knowing that, you couldn't come up with a good hypothesis of what might transfer to some extra art outside of art ability. So that was really the motivation for our Studio Thinking Project, is to study first what was being taught. And so our book on studio thinking is really only a study of teaching. It's a careful analysis of what we saw, the kinds of habits of mind we saw being taught. And that leaves two big steps. What is being learned, and how broad is the learning, and does it spill over outside of the arts? So that's what we're working on now. And we can't study all of these different habits of mind in this way at once in all different art forms. You have to narrow down. So we picked the visual arts, and we picked one of the habits of mind. We picked envision, and we are now doing a study, which I'm going to describe to you, asking the question, when high school students study the visual arts, do they learn to envision better in the arts? And we have a test that we developed for this, which I'm going to show you. And if so, does that predict whether they get better at envisioning outside of the arts? And the domain that we're looking at is geometry, because that's a domain outside of the arts, it's a domain that's cared about by schools, and it's also a very visual spatial domain, and so it's very plausible to think that there might be transfer from the visual arts to geometry. We just finished a correlational study. This is some results that we just got that are not our experimental results, but they're very promising for our experimental results. We did a correlational study simply comparing geometry performance in art students and psychology students in a college. And the studio art students performed way above the psychology students. And this is surprising because the psychology students at a college are usually the more academic, and the studio art students are usually considered the less academic. And perhaps if we'd given them an algebra test, we would not have gotten these results. But with a geometry test, because it's so spatial, we got these very striking results, which we're just analyzing now for publication. And because we got these findings, we can say, maybe it's the training in the visual arts that helps develop these visual spatial skills that make geometry, that improve geometry once students have gotten training in the visual arts. That's one possibility. It's also possible that students with strong visual spatial abilities seek to study the arts, and those same visual spatial abilities that they already had allow them to be good at geometry, in which case we wouldn't be able to make any causal claims about the arts improving spatial skills, which then improve geometry performance. And what I think is probably most likely the case is that students who choose the visual arts do come to it with strong visual spatial skills. I'm not talking about third graders here. I'm talking about college students. And those visual spatial skills then get strengthened by further visual arts training, and that may transfer to geometry. So that's really what I just said. We're trying to tease apart whether the link is causal or correlational. So here's what we're doing. We have a 2-year longitudinal study. We actually convinced the National Science Foundation to fund this. Why? Not because they're particularly interested in visual art, I'm afraid. They're interested in geometry. They gave us the money to do this study, and it's a quasi-experimental study. And when I say that, what I mean is the ideal way to do this study is like a medical study. Take 100 kids and randomly assign them to the art group and the non-art group and follow them over time. We couldn't do random assignment because if you do random assignment, you actually have to provide the treatment. You have to provide the art classes, and we didn't have enough money for that. So we simply took kids who were self-selecting into art classes versus kids who were self-selecting into other things, and we're following them over 2 years. We may actually follow them over 3 years. So our control groups are self-selecting into theater at the same school where students are self-selecting into visual arts, or they're self-selecting into sports. And our hypothesis is that teaching in the visual arts will improve spatial thinking in art, which will then lead to transfer to geometry. So the first thing we had to do was develop a test of spatial thinking in art. And we spent a year working with artists and art educators to develop this measure. And I want to show you a few of the items. These are the different categories of items on the test. So one is going from 3D to 2D. And this is where we ask students to look at a still life. And that's the still life they look at. Not a picture. They see the real thing. And we ask them to simply draw it. And there they have to do the common thing that artists do all the time when they're drawing from observation, put the 3D onto a flat page. And there are two attempts. Going from 2D to 3D, just the converse. We give them this. We show them this two-dimensional picture, and we say a photographer took a photograph of these 8 objects arranged on a grid, and we give them a grid. And we give them the objects, the real objects, in a little baggie, and we say, put them on the grid so that if a photographer took a picture from the same vantage point as this photographer did, you'd get this. And it's actually a quite difficult spatial task. Abstraction. We ask students to look at a complex organic form and reduce it to its simple forms. We give them this, which is the most realistic action figure we could find. It's not a picture. They have the real object in front of them. And we give them an explanation of what we mean by abstraction. We give them these two examples on the side, reducing the shapes to fundamental geometric shapes. Bigger examples. And here are 2 attempts. It's very difficult for students to do this. And then we ask them to do 2 different mental rotation tasks. Here's the first one. We ask them, they're looking at their cup and takeout Chinese food box like this. And we say, without turning it around, we want you to draw how it would look from the back. And that's a mental rotation task. And here you see what they saw from the front, and they had to draw it from the back. They did not see it from the back. And you can see that the only one that really got the spatial relations fairly correctly is that with the cup on the left, partially occluding the box. And we ask them to do the same thing with this action figure. His name is Tracy. We ask them to look at it from the front, up on top, and draw it from the back. And there are 2 attempts to draw it from the back. We have a negative space test where we ask them to look at, we give them, this is in 3 dimensions, we give them these objects pasted on a little cardboard, and we ask them to line it up so they just see the negative space between the man and the duck, and we ask them to just draw the negative space. And most students draw the positive space, and the negative space just falls out. But this student actually just drew the negative space. And finally, we have a projection test where they have to think about shadows. We give them this box, not a picture. It's the real thing. Each kid has a very complicated kit in front of them. And each one of those yellow things are suns, and there's a chess pawn pasted in the middle. And we also show them pictures. And each picture has a particular kind of shadow. So this would be a photograph, and the test is The question is, which sun is making that shadow? And they get to look at the 3D box to help them figure it out, and that's the right answer there. And which one is making this shadow? And this is kind of a tricky one, because the answer is none, and we tell them ahead of time the answer can be none. And this one is one, that's pretty easy. And then we actually have two final items where they have to draw the shadow themselves. We say, imagine the sun is from number four, draw it. And Lois beautifully animated this to show what the right answer would look like. And here's another one, draw what the sun, what it would look like if the sun was shining from nine. And those are two different attempts. That one's correct. Okay, we also give them three standard spatial tests. I'm not going to actually explain these because we're running out of time here. A paper folding test, a mental rotation test, and a water levels test where they have to draw the water level if the bottle was tilted. And you can see how bad students are at this. College students are often bad at this too, believe it or not. It's only the one on the lower right that's correct. Okay. And then we give them a geometry test. Now, what geometry test to use? Well, we didn't want any geometry test that had any verbal items that demand that required you to have memorized formulae or to know definitions. So we looked through all of the items used in national and international tests, and we worked with geometers, and we pulled out the items that we thought were purely spatial and that didn't require verbal knowledge. So here's a really difficult one. This is a drawing of a twisted building and a plan of the ground floor. The compass points show the orientation of the building. Here is a drawing of the building made from the side. From which direction has the building been drawn? So it's really hard. It's really hard for me. But that is the right answer. And if you don't believe me, you come up and ask Lois, because she'll explain it to you. Here's a much easier one. Triangle PQT can be rotated onto triangle SQR. What point is the center of rotation for rotating triangle PQT into triangle SQR? And we read each one of these to the students and answer their questions if they don't understand the terminology. And it's Q, and this just shows you why. They're not allowed to draw to help them understand, to help them figure out the right answer. I'm not going to have time to run through all these. These are just more examples of our items. So, findings. We just analyzed our pre-test findings. We haven't analyzed the art and vision test findings because we're still developing rubrics, but we're almost there. But we analyzed our geometry findings, and lo and behold, we found that the art kids are ahead of the control kids. These are ninth grade kids in the Boston Public Schools. I neglected to say that. So these are not kids who are doing particularly well in school, and they're in underserved schools. But already our art kids who are just starting out in art are doing better in geometry. Now, this suggests that they're coming in with stronger skills. So now what we're going to be doing is looking for change scores. We're just doing our post-testing right now, our first year of post-testing, and we want to find out whether the art students improve more than the control students in geometry. And most importantly, we want to find out whether the degree to which they do well in the art and vision tests predicts the extent to which they change in the geometry. So I just want to conclude by saying that this is a training study, and we're doing this to try to understand the relationship between thinking in the arts and thinking outside of the arts. We're not doing this to say, look, we're trying to give arts advocates a tool for justifying the arts in school, because even if it doesn't turn out that arts increase geometry scores, we still want the arts in schools. But it would be a nice side effect of the arts if students who are not particularly strong academically but who might be strong spatially or artistically, if the arts could be used as an entry point to help them into this spatial area of the non-artistic academic curriculum. I think that we need to beware of sweeping claims that the arts improve test scores and grades and academic performance because, as Lois mentioned, the rigorous studies don't really clearly demonstrate that yet. I think it's better to seek transfer to domains that are really plausibly related to the parent domain, the art domain. And here I think we have done that by looking at a spatial skill, which is plausibly related. The geometry is very plausibly related to the kind of learning you would find in visual arts. And here is my final slide. I designed it to be provocative. Unless you believe in magic, don't look for transfer unless you could explain it, if you found it.
time for questions. We do want to encourage, if you have a question, that you come to the microphone so that your question will be documented. So if you do have a question, please come to the microphone, and you can do that now.
I have a question related to mathematical thinking. And there was just a study that I just read by a cognitive psychologist talking about the difference between spatial reasoning between the appearance of things, which artists tend to be better at, and actual abstract spatial reasoning that scientists tend to be better at. Her name is Maria. She's Russian.
I know who she is, yes.
Yeah. What's her last name?
I know who you mean.
Okay, so I'm just...
I think it starts with a K.
So I'm just wondering how that relates to your
study.
That's
really interesting. Where was that published?
I don't know.
Okay. I'm just writing myself a note because I got to find that study.
Okay. She was looking at... actually, she had three different kinds of reasoning. Verbal reasoning, spatial reasoning, and abstract spatial reasoning, and the kind of spatial reasoning that artists do, which is more... related to the Mooney test. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I don't know that test.
Related to the appearance of things.
Okay.
Being able to...
Okay. It sounds like she's maybe thinking about the difference between observational skill and the ability to manipulate shapes mentally.
Like the mental rotation.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. It has to do with the where and what.
Oh, yes, right. Because there's two different visual systems, the where system being able to locate where things are, and the what thing being able to system being able to identify the identity of the object. So I actually don't know her findings. I don't know whether she actually found that artists were really better at only at the surface of things and not at the manipulation of things.
This is really bothersome to me as an artist who's really interested in science and math. But what she found is that artists are good in a certain kind of spatial reasoning, which is very distinct from the kind of spatial reasoning that scientists are good at.
Well, I need to look at that paper, and I need to look at the measure she used, but I can say that there have been other studies showing that artists are better at mental rotation than non-artists. The comparison was done between artists, mathematicians, and psychology students, and the highest group was the mathematicians. They were the best at mental rotation. And then came the artists, and then came the psychology students who were chosen as the control group. So I'm not convinced that artists aren't good at spatial manipulation, but thank you for telling me about that study.
And don't forget that a single study proves nothing, ever. It's really got to be the accumulated body of literature that can demonstrate. I mean, and the word proof is kind of a funny word, too. I mean, all we're doing is coming to a reasoned conclusion.
I just want to say one follow-up on that study that I think is really relevant to us, which is that her students were in Singapore and in Russia, where the kids are tracked very early to either be science or art. So it could be, and she found real consistency, but that could also be due to the tracking that was going on.
That's interesting.
Yes, and the tracking has to do with first self-selection, selecting the kids who are already strong in one area versus the other, and then the other is very intensive training. And then it's important to look at the kind of training they got.
And also parental support.
Mine is a fairly global question, and it gets to the issue of, if you're thinking like an artist, how do we define an artist in today's art world? Is there any consistent... One thing that struck me, the representation of the three-dimensional world on a two-dimensional surface. Recently, discovered that he had gone through art school and become a very successful artist and that basic skill. So I think this is something that we really need to think about and question.
Yeah, I really agree with you. It's such a big and important question right now because what is being taught in art school is not necessarily the making of objects. could be the making of events or the making of ideas. And the idea reigns so powerfully in the education of artists right now. But that's not true in K-12 art. And K-12 art is usually 50 years behind the art field, at a minimum, I would say. And whether it's behind or ahead?
Yeah.
Well, there is something very important about the object and the hand and the relationship of the hand and the eye. And certainly these kinds of things that we're talking about here are related to that kind. I mean, if you look at the items that we created on our test, they're very closely related to this observational drawing skill or close observation and as a source of developing the envisioning. But it is a real question because artists are doing all sorts of things today. My current definition of a good artwork is one that provokes a conversation that couldn't have happened without it. So.
Hi. Right now we are being plagued by the lack of mental rotation down in the Gulf of Mexico. I would like to suggest, as someone who was in government and politics under six mayors, that as an outcome of this conference, with the leverage of the Guggenheim Museum, the Department of Education, Harvard, Boston University, MIT, Ken Perlin at NYU, et cetera, that we have an op-ed piece or something that talks about how the art making and science making and engineering making, we might have a national conversation about solving. And it's definitely a visual issue, and it has every one of the attributes of everything to do with whatever we were talking about. Not too much. not too much self-reflection going on, that's for sure. But I think with the science in it and some of the what all the different panels are talking about, it would be a fascinating op-ed piece to come out of this with the highest ranking brains writing it. And I just suggest that. Okay.
All right. So I do want to thank everyone here, our panelists, for participating in, and as well as you as the audience, thank you very much. It's just about time for lunch, but I think Amy Charleroi is going to come back up and say a few words.
I just have a quick lunch announcement. So we're heading back up to the rotunda for lunch for the next hour. There is seating in the rotunda. We're serving boxed lunches or sort of buffet-style components of boxed lunches, so you're welcome to stay inside and join us in the rotunda, or you can pack your lunch and take it outside and enjoy it out there if the rain is holding off. To come back in, we're reconvening in here at 1:45 with a keynote by Ellen Lupton. And so to join us back here again at 1:45, you can either take the same route within the museum that you took to get down here on the stairs and the elevator, or we will also have the exterior doors that lead directly into the theater entrance back here open. So you'll take, if you're coming from outside, you'll take the ramp near 88th and 5th down to the doors. So we'll see you back in an hour.